And baseball is very relevant.
Way to stay relevant, baseball. You have maximized the first 2 weeks of February. Really, this was their sweet spot.
Well,
because they knew that they were going to have a couple weeks they could sneak in right after the Super Bowl, before the Combine. They didn't count on the XFL.
And they wanted to get everyone to stop talking about the Astros and the fact that their entire, like, the last three championships have been tarnished by people banging on trash cans.
And sneakily, all they had to do to get us to stop talking about the Astros was to just not have baseball be in the news at all.
Or
because we naturally, in the cyclical nature of sports, this is baseball hibernation season that we're in.
Mm-hmm.
So they could have just kept their mouths shut and we wouldn't bring it up. But they did. They changed the rules. They did a little Mike Greenberg. It's an entire league run by an army of Mike Greenbergs right now. Do you have the rules in front of you?
Yeah, so it's a proposal. And let's back up for a second because this actually is prime baseball season for the most diehard baseball fan you know tweeting 3 days till pitchers and catchers or pitchers and catchers have arrived and we're still 2 months away from meaningful baseball. So
pitchers and catchers, as far as I know, they spend like 1 week away from Arizona and Florida every year. They take like a year vacation from being reported.
It's big season for watching your favorite team, like the new acquisition, throw 10 baseballs off a mound and then go and play 18 holes of golf.
Like you take a picture of them or a grainy video, like a Bigfoot quality video, through a chain link fence that also has that blockade screen laid over it from about 300 yards away.
New rule for baseball. We're going to get to the actual proposed new rules, but here's how you could stay relevant, baseball. Have Bartolo Colon report every single spring, even though he's not on a team anymore, just to see how fat he is.
Just have him report.
Like, just have that be a – that should actually be, like, Punxsutawney Phil. It should be baseball's back. He just reports to just Arizona in general. He doesn't even go to a camp.
He can do both. He can do one Arizona, one Florida, have the families on opposite coasts from each other.
There you go. Perfect.
And then he just shows up carrying like an old school suitcase, wearing a Tommy Bahama shirt and a fedora.
And then boom.
That's the perfect beginning to spring right there.
Okay, so the proposed rule is baseball wants to, I think it's in 2022 it would start, they want to have the playoffs shift to seven teams. Seven teams make the playoffs in the AL and seven teams make the playoff in the NL. Now, what happens from there? The first team, the best team in the league, gets a bye. So both AL and NL have one bye.
Okay.
Then going down the list from there, you have the next best team gets to pick their first round opponent. And so the first round switches. So the first round, instead of the one game playoff, the first round is now a three-game series, all at the higher seed's home stadium. So there's still benefit for being a 2-3 or 4 seed. Or no, 2 or 3 seed.
Okay.
2-3 or 4. Yes, because 5, 6, 7. So 2-3 and 4, all are at home for three games.
Got it.
To start the playoffs. Now, what happens Sunday.
They're all at home for a three-game series?
Yes.
So all three games, or you mean two out of three?
All three games are at home.
Oh, wow, okay.
Yeah, so it gives obviously the benefit, you know, if you're 81-81 and you get the seventh seed, you don't get a home playoff game.
All right, so let me ask you this. If you're in the National League and you're going up against, let's say the Dodgers somehow only get the fifth seed, do you want playoff Kershaw in the first round?
Yeah, this is the intrigue. So this is why, and we'll get to the fallout and people being upset about it, but yes, that's what ends up happening. So you get the selection Sunday, the 2-3 and 4 get to, or 2 and 3 get to pick their opponent, 4 goes with whoever's left.
Yeah.
So the 2 seed gets to pick whoever they want to play. It could be the 7th team, it could be the 5th team. It doesn't matter. Or the fifth team. I'm getting confused.
Gotcha.
With all the numbers.
Basically,
I got all the numbers.
Basically, the four is like the last person at the bar at the end of the night, and you're like, yeah, I guess me and we're going
to
do this.
It's the ultimate bulletin board material because the two seed gets to pick a team and basically say, we're going to kick the shit out of this team, and then that team gets to say, no one believes in us, we're going to kick the shit out of you.
Uh-huh.
And then, of course, the three seed gets to pick, and then the four seed ends up with the five or whoever is left, and that will be the new playoffs, and then they go next round. Goes back to the regular, so four teams are left, regular five-game series.
Got it.
Then the CS. I personally, it's crazy, it's stupid, and I know baseball purists will hate it, but from a fundamental level of making September more enjoyable, making a lot of markets still feel like they have a shot, having just more playoff baseball, which isn't a bad thing, and eliminating the one-game playoff that always kind of feels like it screws someone over, I'm kind of in on this.
Listen, I don't like the one game playoff, even though it worked out really well for the Nationals this year just because of that error in like the eighth inning. But I was very close to being on the wrong side of that one game playoff, and it sucks.
Yeah,
it sucks. I don't like it at all. It doesn't feel fair, like after a 162 game season, to have one game where it's like, okay, you lose, you go home. So I'm with you. I like replacing that. I also like the intrigue of having a bye week, even though I hope that a team I root for never has a bye week. That sounds like it sucks.
Yeah,
to just sit around. And
well, you get to get everyone in line. You get to watch everyone else beat each other up. So it's actually good. I mean, it's a competitive advantage.
I know, but I don't.
And
like
it really isn't that long, because I would assume they would start playing the next series right, like they'd play the first round right away.
Yeah,
so it'd be like Thursday or Friday would be your first game.
I don't like the idea of a bye week. I don't like it. I like keeping in rhythm. If you're a baseball team,
rest versus rust debate.
There we go.
We
can have it every single year. Circumstance. But I do like how it's messing with people's brains, because you're right. The outcome of all this is, I think it's more fun. It's more fun, and it screws things up because people in the past are like, wait, this is change. Baseball people don't like change. But at the end of the day, I think that this is a pretty entertaining way of doing it. It's just weird. It's just weird.
It is weird.
It took us like 5 minutes to explain what the hell is going on, and that's 4 minutes more than my brain in this age of the internet can process.
So the downside, and I understand this, the baseball season's already very, very long. I actually think it should be about 10 games shorter regardless, and don't play all the way till December, although snow baseball would be incredible. But the downside is this. You will end up having a bunch of rich owners try to tell their fan base that they've made the playoffs 3 or 4 years in a row when they were like 82-80 and getting the 6th or 7th seed. There will be some crappy teams that get into the tournament, and that is kind of bullshit. And you have like that whole, owners can basically never have to go all in, because they can sell to their fan base that they're always competitive because they finished 3 games away from making the playoffs, even though in, you know, the way it's currently constructed, they would have been 10 games out or something. I still think this would be like, it's more fun. There's more teams. It's more fun. The trade deadline gets more intriguing. The September gets more intriguing. Like, it all seems like it would make sense. I know that baseball is the last sport to change, but this feels like I'm in.
Okay, the other side of that coin that you just mentioned, which is some shittier teams can make the playoffs, we get upsets in the playoffs now.
Yeah.
We can have Cinderella stories in the playoffs. We can have a team like can you imagine a 7 seed?
The Mets last year, I think, would have made it as a 6 or 7 seed.
Yeah, can you imagine?
They had one of the best pitching rotations.
Can you imagine a 7? Now that I've got my own personal untainted World Series title as a diehard Nats fan, I'm fine with whatever screwy changes they make and somebody sneaking in as a 7th seed to the World Series next year. Like, I'm fine with that. I think you're right. The more fan bases that are involved later on in the season, the better for everybody. And you know what? Those owners that are going to say, well, you know what? We made the playoffs. We don't have to change that much. They're the same owners that are just not going to change anything anyways.
Right. Like, the shitty teams getting in, that kind of will suck. Like, I'm looking at it right now. I think everyone would have been
NBA.
Everyone would have been over 500. Yeah, there's the argument.
It's a chicken and a chair. That's all we need.
Almost half the league is making the playoffs. But, okay. I mean, that's still fun.
NHL, too. It's like, I don't see a problem with that long term, because back in the day,
it's encouraging mediocrity, though.
Well, but here's the problem. Baseball,
I'm fine with that.
For a team that is out in, I don't know, July, like, that happens all the time in baseball. I feel like more teams would be invested, more cities wouldn't be invested. Like, take the Seattle Mariners, for example. Seattle hasn't made the playoffs in 20 years. I don't think people realize that. They haven't made the playoffs since 2001. Like, that would be fun to have Seattle playoff baseball either in Seattle. They wouldn't make it in Seattle because it wouldn't be good enough. But maybe they'd get in there.
It's paying off the owners that haven't put in the effort to make their team playoff worthy.
I agree with that.
Paying off the people that are just taking advantage of the fans.
I agree with that. That is a fundamental flaw in this.
But, Hank, it's also giving you a chance. It's like it's saying that, like, I'm sure Seattle would be fine with having their owner continue to not, like, strive for greatness and do anything to try to win them a World Series if it meant – that they had been in the playoffs like 5 of the last 20 years.
And
they got that like 1 week of glory. As a Redskins fan, that one wild card that we get once every like 6 years is an electric weekend.
I'm addicted to In the Hunt.
We get an
Everyone's
In the Hunt.
In the Hunt. Everyone is in the hunt at all times.
It's funny because like this seems
it's just
like
a bailout for the owners. That's how
it is. No, and it also is. This is
Hank Leftwood.
We immediately this.
It is
the millionaires and the billionaires.
It's the participation trophy. But we by the way, participation trophies. Like just a quick word on that. As soon as I became a dad, like my son got a gold medal for just showing up to gym, and he deserved that gold medal. Like I was like, fuck yeah, you got that, dude. You fucking showed up. Well, so I'm all in on participation trophies. I'm that flipped in my brain.
I'm fine with participation trophies.
I love
What's
my
the
kid.
First thing that you do? You give him like bronze shoes, dude. Right? It's like, yeah, here you go. You made it into the world.
I texted everyone in the picture. I was like, check it out. Gold medal. No big deal. He's only 6 months old. It's like, what'd he do? Well, he sat there. And he sat there.
Mm-hmm.
But guess what? Gold medal.
Leroy one time got a certificate for not getting kicked out of obedience class.
That's huge.
That was massive for
That's
me.
That's huge.
So I'm fine with that. And going back to like rewarding mediocrity, I'm going to flip it because some people say we reward mediocrity too much. I think that the best life lesson of all is teaching you that if you're perfectly average at something and you get hot at the right time in the right place, you can be great.
Yeah,
that's ultimately
Eli Manning.
That's the best.
Eli Manning.
Yeah, that's the best lesson that you can learn in life. Forget this bullshit where it's like you have to strive to succeed and dominate everything if you want greatness. That's not true at all.
No.
As long as you're like averagely consistent at something,
we're all,
and then you peak at the right time,
right.
Boom. That's as great as you could hope for in a life.
No one's really special. You can have special moments though.
That's
like,
right.
My son's gold medal.
Right. Well, that,
fucking special.
Honestly, don't diminish that. He showed up for gym.
He did. He was there.
But this does sound like an Adam Silver idea that,
yeah.
that he got. He gets his ideas from Twitter, and Rob Manfred gets his ideas from Arrowwood.